Hello everyone, Matt here. In this tutorial, we'll learn how to make a furnace that supports multiple recipes and fuels. First, we need to create the textures, then we'll learn how to create a user interface for the furnace, afterwards we'll create the block and adjust its properties to work with the procedures. There will be two procedures, the first one will be used for smelting and the second one for special effects. I'll explain why it's good to have separate procedures instead of one later. For the textures, I'll use the integrated editor as it has all the features I need to create one. I'll use the stamp tool to paste the base for the top and bottom texture and export it. I'll do the same for the side textures. For the front texture, I'll add some detail like the fire and some vents on top with some glow for the fire. Now we can create our furnace user interface. First, I'll make it a GUI with slots and add a label saying custom furnace. I'll put it in the top left corner. Afterwards, I'll add a label which will show how much fuel is left in the furnace. Note that this is completely optional. In the label, we need to add a tag saying BMBT, which stands for block MBT, integer tag name, meaning that the text will be replaced with a block's MBT value of a type integer with name tag name. I'll change the tag name to fuel remaining, since that will be the name of the tag we'll use for storing remaining fuel percentage. I'll also name the number with fuel and add a percentage sign on the right side of it, since it will show the remaining fuel percentage. Since percentages are always 3 or fewer characters long, I don't need to worry about the label spanning out of the window, since the value will be replaced with something shorter when in game. So I'll just try to align it with the GUI's name. Afterwards, we can add the slots. You can copy the grid settings I'll use or simply use your own if you wish so. I'll start with the input slots. The slot with ID0 will be used as the item input slot, and slot ID1 will be used as the fuel slot. We only have one output slot, which will have ID2. At this point, we are done with the user interface, so I'll move on to block creation. I'd like to warn you that even though this part of the process may sound trivial, there are some settings you don't want to miss, because your furnace might misbehave if you skip it. First, we set the left texture to the side texture, because it sets all the texture to it and the side texture is on most of the block sides. Then we set the front face to the burning furnace texture, and top and bottom ones to the respective textures. We also want to set the rotation to y-axis rotation southwest-northeast from player side. On the next page, I'll rename the block to custom furnace, set its step sound to stone and put it in the decoration step, since that's where all the vanilla crafting blocks are for some reason. I'll also set its tool of choice to be pickaxe. Now this is an important part. Make sure that your block stick rate is set to 1, or else your furnace might appear slower than expected. Also make sure that you set the reaction to being pushed to block, because allowing blocks with inventory to move leads to weird behavior in Java Edition, which is the reason why all vanilla blocks with inventory cannot be pushed by pistons as well. You can leave all other settings as default. Moving over to the next page, we bind the block to the furnace GUI we created earlier. Make it open when right-clicking on the block and enable inventory for this block. Size of inventory is 3, max size of the stack can be left at the default 64. We also want it to drop items when destroyed and output comparator data. To make it work with hoppers, we also need to specify the output slots, which in our case is slot 2. At this point, we don't set any procedures, but we'll be using update tick and client display random tick later down the line. We can skip the last page since we don't want the block to spawn in the world. Now onto the procedures. I'll split the furnace procedure into two, one for logic and the other for effects. Not only is this the proper way to do so, but it is also better because we only need the logic part to run both on the server and on client side for it to work, while particles and sound can be left for the client to handle. This way we can reduce the load on the server, which means that it will run faster and use fewer resources, which is always a good thing. Since I'd like to make this tutorial in a way that anyone can follow, I'll avoid explaining the procedure block by block, but I will tell you how to modify it to add new recipes and fuels. If you want to understand how everything works so that you can replicate something similar in the future or perhaps upgrade it, I'll be making a separate tutorial that will describe it in depth soon, so stay tuned. When I'll upload it, I'll put up a card in the top right corner and its link in the description. I created templates for both procedures, which can be found on the mods page download section on the MCreator's website, which is linked in the description. Make sure to download them before proceeding with this tutorial, as they will be necessary for the following steps. Did you download them yet? Thought so. I'll wait. I have a lot of time. Never mind. I'll stop waiting in 3 seconds. Let's start with the furnace tick procedure. First, we create a blank procedure, name it furnace tick, and in the top right corner, click import procedure. Select the furnace tick.ptpl procedure template you just downloaded and click open. Now drag the imported procedure blocks so that they connect with the green start block. Notice that the local variables are now missing, so we need to create them and relink them with the respective blocks. In our procedure, we only have one variable, so the process is really simple. The local variable list is located under the import procedure button we just used. Click on the green plus button to create a new variable and name it previous recipe. Make sure that its type is set to number and click OK. Now we need to replace the set block in the top to update its variable drop-down menu, as well as the get block in this if block. Now we have a working smelting procedure, and we can start modifying it. Let's start with something simple, such as smelting time, or as I like to call it, smelting cycle duration. You can set the smelting time by adjusting this number here. Currently it is set to 20 ticks, which means 1 second. Setting it to 1 will make it smelt an item every single game tick, while setting it to, for example, 40, will make items smelt for 2 seconds. Note that this affects fuel efficiency, since it takes less, or in other cases more, fuel ticks to smelt. Now we can move on to adding and editing recipes. Because of how this procedure works, all recipes must be given a positive ID number. This is because it needs to remember which was the last recipe, so that it resets the item smelting timer when recipes change mid-smelt. There are currently 2 recipes defined, one for diamond ore smelting with ID 0 and one for smelting unstackable diamond swords with ID 1. In this first if statement, I defined when items in furnace's inventory match the recipe in a way that it would allow the next smelting cycle to finish, without overriding or deleting items. In this if statement, I define what the furnace does every smelting cycle for each recipe. Now let's add another recipe for a stackable item. I'll add a recipe for smelting iron ore into 3 iron ingots. I'll start by adding another else if block to the if statement and copy the condition and body from the diamond smelting recipe. First, I want to change the recipe's ID to 2. Then I'll replace diamond ore with an iron ore and the diamond gem with an iron ingot. Now, because our newly added recipe gives 3 items, we also need to adjust this number. It tells how many items can be in the output slot for the recipe to still be valid, which means that no items will go to waste, so it needs to be set to maximum stack size, minus the number of items we get per smelting cycle. Now we also need to define what happens when an item is smelted. We repeat the same process of adding an else if to the if statement here, and copy the condition and body from the diamond smelting procedure. In the condition, we change the ID to 2, replace the diamond gem with an iron ingot, and change the number of items added to the slot to 3. This is it, we now have an efficient iron smelting recipe. If we, for example, wanted to add a recipe for non-stackable items, we can skip most of the conditions in the first if statement, much like it's already done in the provided example. With some minor adjustments, we could also have more items required in the input slot and much more. But for the sake of simplicity, I'll go over that in another video while I explain how this procedure works in detail. I'll also link it in the description when it's released. Adding fuel types is much easier than adding a recipe. We add another else if to this if statement here, and copy the condition and body from another fuel. We first need to change the item it checks for to something we want to use as fuel. In my case, I'll use coal. Now we need to adjust the fuel burning time, both in the fuel and max fuel. I'll set it to 20, to make it a bit less efficient compared to coal blocks. Note that these numbers are by no means balanced or meant to be used as final values when adding a furnace like this into your mod. With these values, it takes 1 coal to smelt a single item, which is a bit expensive in my opinion. The next part will make the furnace look cooler by adding some special effects like particles that fly out of the block depending on how much fuel there's left and hear crackling sound when it's melting. For that we need to create another blank procedure. Name it Furnace Display Tick and much like we did for the other procedure, click Import Procedure in the top right corner. Select the furnace display tick.ptpl and click Open. Now drag the imported procedure blocks so that they connect with the green start block. Create a new variable, name it fire height, set its type to number and click OK. Now we need to replace this set block in the top for the same reasons we had to do that in the previous procedure. We have to repeat the process for all the get blocks in the following lines. Now we have a working effect procedure that will make sure you notice it's melting from miles away. The last thing we need to do now is to bind all the procedures to our furnace block. Open it and click Next Page until you see the procedure panels. In the Update Tick section, click Furnace Tick, and in the Client Display Random Tick, select the Furnace Display Tick procedure. This way the logic part will be running on the server and effects only on the client. That's it, we're done. We can now go and check out our furnace in-game. We can check out some fuels and the recipes we added. Thank you for watching this tutorial. If you're interested in working with friends, make sure to check out the Git series. If you'd like to know exactly how this procedure works, check out the video dedicated to that in case it's already uploaded by the time you're watching this. Don't forget to subscribe, turn on the notifications, like for more content like this, and comment with suggestions down below. Stay tuned!